Keaton on the bazooki and the guitar, Danny Novak on the fiddle and the guitar, my name's Quinn Cohen, and I was here, Matt was here once, almost 10 years ago with his wife Shannon, Matt and Shannon duo, and I was here last year, beginning the season of playing the band in Olivia, and it's wonderful to be back. I've been with Paul for almost a couple of years now. I first met him right when I moved to go to the North Shore and play for his daughter's wedding reception. And it was, we had a great time getting together and planning that and connecting over, bless you, a sort of commiseration over mutual interest in obscure string music. And he told me about his concert series and we ended up here. Quick mention, as Paul suggested, we would tell you about the name of our group. We were a quartet, and we started about a year ago, a little more than a year ago, and our fourth member, who was a great virtuoso mandolin player and guitar player, one of the most well-known in the Northeast, didn't tour much, but really everyone in the know knew about him, and he was a mentor to me for many years, 15, almost 20 years, and his name was John McGann. Passed away a few months ago, sadly. This was the last gig that we had on the books with him, so he would have been here. And he made it, but other nature took him from us. So he came up with the name, the Deadstring name was, he was producing my first record and recording it at his house back in Boston many years ago, 10 years ago, and I insisted on recording the rhythm guitar parts with worn-in strings, but he insisted that I record the lead guitar parts with brand new strings. So we tracked the whole thing with the new strings, and I said, I'll play on the strings for 2 weeks or 3 weeks and come back and we'll re-record the rhythm parts with the worn-in strings. And so the day I showed up on his doorstep with the worn-in strings, he says, John, this is John McGann speaking, he says, opens the door and he says, okay, we're going to record Deadstring Rhythm today. And I said, that's the name of the album. So we named the album Deadstring Rhythm, and then 10 years later put the band together and called it Deadstring Ensemble. But if you end up with my email address, you'll realize it has Deadstring in it and all that stuff. So we don't perform on Deadstrings, but we can help it for whatever that's worth. It's a little self-effacing. But anyway, it's an eerie dead crowd, so I think you guys can handle it. So, we are going to do a traditional song. A lot of the stuff we play from the Irish music tradition, as well as a little bit of traditional American fiddle music and songs, and original music that's very much inspired by those traditions, as well as some early music from British Isles, and would you say acoustic prog rock, and kind of thing. So here we go. Here's a traditional song that I heard from the singing of Paul Brady, who's my favorite Irish singer. It's called Mary and Soldier. Last night.
play guitar with a lot of different fiddle players, which meant that we never got to play together because we were working with a lot of the same people at different times, so we never really, we would see each other once in a while, but never really got to spend any quality time together until a few years ago, the Boston Celtic Music Festival, which is a lovely little festival in January that encourages weird projects from people. We decided that last song was recorded by Paul Brady and Andy Irvine on a classic record they did in the 70s, and we decided that our weird project was going to be to cover the entire record. And so we learned all the parts, and I grew a beard, and we were very authentic and inspired internet outrage and everything. So we haven't looked back since.
That's great. So we're going to be playing a few original things that I wrote from my and recorded in my two most recent solo albums, Mellow Yell and the latest, which is called Fierce Modal. And the next few things we're going to do are off the new one. This is definitely a Celtic meets Americana fiddle tune sort of thing called The Good Part. And it was originally recorded by my friend Joe Walsh, who plays in a band called the Gibson Brothers and the Grass Band, you may have heard of. His first solo record. And I found a my own version of it and recorded it with this guy down in Whittle, who's a fabulous fiddle player who just graduated from Berkeley. And that's it. It's called The Good Part. Hope you like it. It's definitely got some multi-genre action for all you eclectic music fans. Thank you.
take this sort of male geekery to a different place. Nowadays they have these emery boards with seven different surfaces on it. It seems like cheating to me. I have one file and then a piece of aluminum oxide sandpaper that's meant for auto body work, and that I prefer. But yeah. Actually, there's one thing on your phone where you press it, it gets rougher. Getting to this great point, the reflection of all of the things I can take out.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay, just look off your stand.
Okay, that's good. Okay, cool. Okay, so the next two things we're going to play for you are delicate guitar duets, definitely inspired by many ways the classical guitar tradition, but also very much inspired, especially musically, artistically, by the sound world, kind of reinvented by what we call the pentangle, and guitarists like John Renborn, Bergage, Davy Graham, and English guitar players back in the late 60s and early 70s who sort of revisited a combination of Elizabethan lute music and English folk music, and guitar techniques borrowed from Delta blues as well. So an interesting fusion of music. We're sort of taking it back. A little cross-fertilization going on here. I borrowed, maybe I shouldn't tell my secrets here, but I borrowed all the rhythmic values from a Galliard, which is like a particular kind of dance form, written by composer Thomas Robinson, around a little labyrinth of William Shakespeare. Basically took his piece, a music teacher in prison, something called the Citern, and just took the rhythmic values and replaced all the notes, wrote my own chords and parts and stuff, and wrote this as my wedding march.
I'm gonna put it out there for you.
Yeah.
For the future banter.
Yeah.
That the fact that you wrote it for your wedding might be more interesting than the rhythmic values.
Okay. Yeah. So anyway, I borrowed some of the form from an Elizabethan composer, and then this was composed originally for tuba and trombone.
Also interesting.
This is why I bring him along. See, I drank some coffee on the way here, and he's going to be here to keep me in check with the phantom star. Okay.
It's good to connect us with the general theme of values. That's very
important. Yeah, we're in chat on all that.
Yeah. The amazing thing is the piece actually takes like a minute. So we're
slower.
baby present to my friend Matt here. He had a baby.
Again, the interesting part. my wife and I had a baby. He'll be two in September, and we solicited a lot of our musician friends for lullabies. And so we have this, we have a lullaby playlist that featuring an awful lot of really, really lovely stuff, including this one here, which is the official, oh wow, he even used the S that looks like an F. It's called Master Nigel Heaton, his Galliard, which is a very Shakespearean way of putting it.
But indeed.
Indeed. So, but this is another lovely tune of Flynn's.
Thank you. Oh, no, wait.
So Matt is going to sing you a song off of his most recent duet album of question. The album is called Lovers Well. This is a, I would say it's a quasi title track. As like,
it has the word lovers in it.
Yeah, it's got one of the words in the title.
This is actually, it's a, the song is called The Lover's Lament, and it's a version, there are a bunch of versions of this bouncing around. It's also known as the Blackest Crow. You'll hear it over here. This is kind of a mixture Irish-American version. But it is also, when I was first working on this song, it takes me a really long time to remember lyrics, and so one of my strategies is if I'm working on something, I will just, you know, sing it because I'm going about doing other things during the day. And one of the things that I happened to be doing when I was working on this song was tearing down a concrete retaining wall in our backyard, and with a sledgehammer. And it's amazing that the most beautiful, delicate song, when you start swinging a sledgehammer, just turns into a prison work song. And so I sort of ended up with it ended up putting this kind of rhythm, just almost inadvertently, because that was about how long it took me to swing the hammer at it. But
thank you.
going to now deliver a 3-hour lecture on.
Deeper.
it's a depending on who you talk to, it's either an Irish bouzouki because of the tuning or an Ottoman mandolin because of the length. But either way, it's basically an overgrown mandolin. And both of these things are cursed with doubles with unison strings, so you've got twice as many opportunities to be slightly out of tune. A lot of these instruments were kind of brought into the Irish music world in the 60s and 70s from Greece and various other spots. And this particular one is built by it's an Irish version of a Greek instrument, and it was built by a Scottish guy who lives in New Zealand. So there's the world music aspect. Now we'll do a song which.
Well, this actually is also, this also has a deep lineage. This is a song that was originally from the Scots, Irish, English language balancing tradition, brought to the States in the mid-18th century. And this version came to me from a field recording of a Western North Carolina traditional singer, Frank Proppit, recorded back in the 1950s. So his ancestors came over from Northern Ireland. Yeah, so mid-1700s. And so this song has deep roots and branches as well. The Led Zeppelin recorded a version of this song on their third album, a lot of acoustic stuff, which was more traditionally inspired. And I'm sure there are a lot of Zeppelin fans in the audience tonight. So, but anyway, to answer the branches, section of this. So this is called Hangman, and I recorded this on my Mellow Yell CD, the full vocal duet with Hugh Foden, and some of you may be familiar with Cricket Still. And when my wife has nothing else going on, she'll often come to the gigs with me, and she'll sing this one because she's a great singer, but she won't make it tonight, unfortunately, so I'm going to be singing the air unless Matthew gets inspired. He's threatened. Anyway, this is our last number for the half. We're going to take a break, eat some watermelon, look forward to meeting some of you, or all of you if possible, although I know at least half of you are going to be in the line to use the exotic toilet. So, anyway, feel free to sign a mailing list, check out our CDs, and we'll see you outside with some watermelon, and back in the second half after a week.
Hold up your hand.
Thank you. let's sing you a song.
Sure. I decided I sort of changed gears, and I'm going to sing something which I wrote a few years ago because Louise mentioned it at the half. And this is I am a big unapologetic fan of bicycle racing. Yes, I know it's totally fueled by drugs of various consistencies, but man, I just love it. And I'm more than willing to get up to crack of dawn and watch the Tour de France, which will be happening next month. But I'm also a big fan of bicycling as you know, various kinds of transportation and especially whenever I come out, we live in Boston, and whenever I come out to Western Mass, I always wish I had brought my bicycle, because it just seems like such a much more pleasant place to do it than in town. But I do find when you go around playing acoustic music, you run into some interesting bicycle characters. Just like there are interesting music characters, a lot of interesting bike characters too. And one that comes to mind, my wife Shannon and I once played a show in Portland, somewhere in Oregon, and it was kind of like a kind of cold, drizzly night. You know, not freezing, but certainly not, you know, you'd want a jacket. And the sound guy he had these, you know, these crazy homemade speakers and all this very idiosyncratic gear. And he was wearing shorts, and I you know, made some stupid joke like, oh, it's kind of cold, you're wearing shorts. And he was like, oh yeah, you know, I work up a sweat riding my bike home. I'm like, oh yeah, you know, I see how that could go. And then I thought about this thing. I was like, wait, weren't you setting all this gear up when you got here? And he's like, yeah, come here, let me show you something. And he had brought in the whole PA on his bike. He had like two trailers. He had like a little train sort of thing. It was just amazing. But anyway, so this song, but I digress. This song is called The Giant of the Road. And it was written, before Floyd Landis lost his title for doping, before Tyler Hamilton got barred for 2 years, it was a more innocent time. John wakes up before the sun on the 17th of May. His eyes go wide. Brand new shrink stingray. Now he skids through close flies off curves. His first real taste of freedom. When his dad put on those training wheels, John said he didn't need them. In his mind, he's Eddie Murchison. In his mind, he's Lance. He can hear Phil Lincoln say, see how those pedals dance. He still rides a straight line like his daddy showed. Every time the wheels go round, he's a giant of the road. Down the yellow line, how it feels. 15, too young to drive a car, not too young to date. He loves the feeling of the night when he comes so late. In his mind, he's Eddie Murchison, in his mind, he's Lance. He can hear Phil Lickett say, how those pedals dance. He still rides a straight line like his daddy showed. Every time the wheels go round, he's a giant of the road. Driveway, and she knows someday
When we write stuff, this we abbreviate things. It's very easy to confuse people, and we're doing our best to that tonight. We're going to play some Meals and Cover of Ireland. And Matt had mentioned the pluck strings are kind of a new addition to the tradition for that music. It comes from America. And so, as I mentioned before, there's cross fertilization happening between all the different kinds of music, but it's definitely a relationship. Not just through immigration between the music styles, but also because of the commercialization of everything, the iTunes application, and the interwebs. We have incredible, unlimited access to everything that's ever been commercially recorded and distributed. So the club strings, as Matt mentioned, can be of complex and even suspicious lineage, like his bazooka here. And so anyway, here's a couple of reels. The first is called Fred Finn's, and the second is called Sailing into Walpole's Marsh. Thank you. which I went to college in England, and we call it interval over there. And that's can be very confusing, because interval over here is a space between two notes. So, I met you during the space between two notes. Now, an interesting couple that I met during the half over an amazing watermelon, thank you, Paul. We had a discussion about this instrument, which is called the Shruti Box, which comes from India. And it's basically a drone. It's definitely a lot more interesting, I think, to look at, maybe, than what it produces in terms of, you know, sound. People always ask about it, and it's a little curious thing going on. But anyway, I'm going to accompany myself singing a traditional American song, which also has most likely has some roots in Scots, Irish ballads, but it's very much a Western North Carolina traditional song. It's like with many of the ballads, it involves a broken heart. There's no death in the song, which is another common theme, which are called murder ballads, of course. It's not a murder ballad, it's a love and leave kind of ballad. And because these songs weren't commercial songs, they didn't have titles in the same way that Lennon and McCartney titled their songs, or any other commercial act titles of songs. So these songs are often just known as, or maybe left the first line. So, this song you sing is called A Sailor Being Tired, which I guess could be a commercial title or something more artsy. Maybe you see some indie mode rock band in Northampton. Okay.
Sailor being tired. Sailor being tired when he hung down his head, he asked the little maid for a show hand to bed. She showed him a bed like maid ought to do. Thank you. If it is a girl child, I hear it in hers. Sitting on her knees for to comb its curly hair.
Thank you.
Thompson, and my favorite music of his comes from the early to mid-70s, recordings with his ex-wife, Linda, who's a fantastic singer. She was his wife. Yes, it's crazy to know that. What happens, unfortunately, when you listen to the old stuff. But the title track of an album that was only released in this, re-released in the States in the last couple of years, but was out of print for 30 years, let's say, and it was from around 1975. Despite the challenging weather conditions. first one. It's like March, it's almost spring, right? And so there's, we got a big snowstorm in Boston.
It wasn't even that big a snowstorm. This past winter, which didn't really exist other than, you know, the blizzard in October, we got like a pretty good dusting, but after
no snow.
After the entire, everyone was like, oh, no, you want to go out in that now. Oh, jeez, if you looked outside, no.
Thanks again for coming out. One more time, on the bouzouki and the guitar, Matt Eden, please.
Thank you.
wonderful line in it where he said, if you're about to do something very difficult, by all means, let your audience know.
And that's what we're about to do.
I just want to let you know how hard it is. Interpretations of these three tunes. They were some of the first